Imagine what would happen if, millions of years into the future, scientists, perhaps from other planets, tried to create depictions of the long-extinct organisms they found in Earth's fossil record. Perhaps they'd create images of the deadly swans who spear prey with their long, hooked forearms, or of the predatory hippo, a behemoth with imposing fangs and deadly jaws. But wait, that's not what a hippo looks like, or what a swan looks like. These future scientists are way off. Well, these are examples of how, when recreating extinct species in those extreme cases where one lacks any information on muscle and fatty tissue and only has the skeleton to work with, things can get a little off. These images are part of a thought experiment, All Today's, written in part by the astonishing author C.M. Koseman, whose work you might have seen from his other most famous book, All Tomorrow's. All Today's is a section in the larger 2012 art book All Yesterday's, dreamed up not just by C.M. Koseman, but Darren Naish, a renowned zoologist, paleontologist, and author, and John Conway, an immensely talented paleo-artist. These three are incredible creators, and I have links to where you can follow and support them in this video's description. And they're All Today's thought experiment of how imaginary future scientists might grossly misinterpret the animals we're familiar with is worth looking at further. The section is intended to help people think critically about the ways in which we've portrayed past animals ourselves, like dinosaurs, in ways that aren't quite accurate. Early paleo artists sometimes portrayed dinosaurs as emaciated creatures with exaggerated, monstrous features, a trend sometimes referred to as shrink wrapping, which both Koseman, Naish, and Conway have helped push against with All Yesterday's. Now, it's worth noting some people who haven't actually read the book have assumed these illustrations are mocking the mistakes past paleontologists made in recreating dinosaurs, which isn't the case. All Yesterday's is imagining an entertaining worst-case scenario, where no muscle or skin has been preserved on the fossils of familiar modern animals, and scientists completely out of touch with what modern animals might look like are trying to piece them together from fragmented remains. And the result is truly worth documenting in the archive. So let's get started and look at the ways in which paleontologists of the future might imagine the species of the past. The first image the hypothetical future scientists have created of life from Earth's past is this illustration of a deadly hunter, rendered in fearsome detail by John Conway. But don't worry too much, because this is an erroneous interpretation of a house cat. That's right, the furry, whiskered felines which populate our homes have, without any reference for the future paleontologist to go off of, been conceptualized as scaly, frightening beasts. A pretty amusing misreading, although modern cats, despite their appearance, are indeed proficient predators. Next, we have a portrait of a bony, agile organism, which honestly resembles some of the creatures out of Koseman's All Tomorrow's. Despite all appearances, however, this is a hypothetical, inaccurate recreation of a zebra. You'd be forgiven if you didn't make the connection, as most of the features one associates with the animals, like their stripes, mane, and overall body shape, have been left out. The future paleontologists have also misunderstood the animal's hooves, instead guessing the organism has strange, single-toed feet. The hooves which zebras and other equids use to get around are pretty unique in the animal kingdom, so it makes sense why such an adaptation might not occur to future scientists. This emaciated, angular, reptilian-looking beast is a hypothetical misinterpretation of a rhinoceros, which misses the animal's thick, protective skin and overall heavyset body structure. The recreation also sports a bizarre sail-like frill on the animal's back, which the imagined scientists believe helped the animal shed excess heat. This erroneous sail comes from a misunderstanding surrounding the pronounced vertebrae on the skeleton of the real-life animal. Another notable error? The fictional recreation is also missing one of the most well-known features of the rhino, its horn. As rhino horns are made out of keratin and wouldn't fossilize well like other bones in the animal's skeleton, any future paleontologist might be left in the dark about the animal's most distinguishing characteristic. Another animal missing its most distinguishing characteristic, and looking unrecognizable as a result, is the elephant, pictured here bereft of its trunk. This is an intriguing example of how an imagined reconstruction of a modern animal might be too cautious. After all, the very concept of an elephant's trunk is unique and downright peculiar even in context, so one can imagine why it wouldn't occur to a future paleontologist. Especially when you consider that the elephant's trunk is a muscular appendage without any internal skeletal structure, meaning it wouldn't be preserved in any kind of fossil record. There are aspects of an elephant skull which do hint at the existence of a trunk, but it's not hard to imagine that a careful scientist of the future might err on the side of caution and dismiss such a possibility. The next erroneous reconstruction shows a thick-furred herbivore in a mountainous habitat. What species is this image based on? The manatee, an animal which is certainly not furry and certainly not on land. But the author imagines the future paleontologists only have access to the animal's skull, which resembles that of a standard grass-dwelling herbivore. So imagining the rest of the animal would be a four-legged furry land dweller isn't too big a leap, even if it's obviously incorrect. Another hypothetical interpretation which misses the mark is this portrait of a lithe, deadly predator that runs on all fours to intercept prey. We know this animal as a baboon, and also know it's quite different from what the fictional paleontologists imagined it to be, possessing fur and an arboreal lifestyle. The future scientists also believe the animal secreted deadly venom from its front teeth. Baboon fangs actually do possess unique grooves, a feature sometimes found in venomous animals for reasons that aren't completely clear. So while the concept of a venomous baboon seems absurd to us, someone lacking all knowledge of the animal might make that very mistake. Real paleontologists have indeed made similar errors, like theories that Cretaceous period dinosaur Cynornithosaurus possessed a venomous bite due to its grooved teeth, a hypothesis that was later proven false. Even more frightening than a venomous baboon, we have this long-fingered predator interpreted as something right out of a nightmare. You can really see Koseman's All Tomorrow style coming through here. But in our time, we know the species as something much less frightening, the tiny, furry spider monkey. Here, our imagined future paleontologists interpreted the uniquely long finger bones present in a spider monkey skeleton as gaunt, claw-like digits. And I think we can all be glad this is a species that doesn't actually exist in this form. Moving on from the primates, the next animal recreation from our fictionalized scientists is a parasite that sucks the blood from larger animals. The image might be unnerving, but the real animal is based on certainly isn't. That's right, it's the one and only hummingbird, a fast-moving, brightly colored bird which gets its sustenance from nectar instead of from any kind of helpless animal. Hummingbirds are so innocent-looking, it's hard to imagine anyone interpreting this animal as anything frightening. But hummingbird skeletons are pretty weird, with strange proportions and long, serrated beaks. We know the curiously lengthy beaks of hummingbirds are for the purpose of accessing nectar, but this might not be easily discernible without context. So who's to say imagined future paleontologists might not land on a theory that hummingbirds are blood-sucking parasites? Here's a second misinterpretation of a species of bird, imagined as another featherless, gaunt animal with claws at the end of what should be their wings. The unique shape of their beak signals that this animal is a recreation of a hornbill, a bird which already looks like it's from another time. If you're wondering why our future scientists assume both this and the hummingbird didn't have feathers, it's likely because feathers aren't always preserved clearly in the fossil record. And indeed, a similar thing happened when paleontologists originally missed that dinosaurs like velociraptors had feathers. And so the hornbills are drawn as scaly beasts, unable to take flight. Nearing the end of our glimpse at all today's, we have a portrait of an animal with an unusually long body and four stumpy legs. Despite appearances, this is a theoretical misunderstanding of a snake. To us, it's obvious that snakes don't have legs. I mean, just look at them. but to someone who only knew a snake through fragmentary remains, they might assume the skeleton they were exhuming was incomplete. After all, it does seem hard to believe that the snake, unlike almost all other related reptiles one might uncover, simply wouldn't have the main thing land animals use to get around. And at the end of this limited preview of all today's, we have a speedy, bony organism that looks like an animal you wouldn't want to cross. So what creature have the future paleontologists misjudged this time? The cow. Yep, the bulky, grass-chewing herbivores themselves. Cows are so ingrained in our modern consciousness, the notion of anyone imagining these animals as lithe, agile organisms certainly seems silly. But maybe you just have to have seen a cow to understand. And that's the end of our glimpse at the All Today's section of Koseman's, Naish's, and Conway's unbelievably cool All Yesterdays. If you like this content, please consider supporting Koseman, Naish, and Conway's incredible book by purchasing a copy, and by patronizing their other works and social media, which again you can find in the links below. Also, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this entry, please lend your support, and like, subscribe, and hit the notification icon to stay up to date on all things curious. See you in the next video.